Welcome back to the Blue Door Pub Thunderdome for another Bull with Andy Carlson, Minnesota's 87th best daily podcast. Hit 'em with the horn. Show about everything and nothing 5 days a week. Happy Friday, one and all. Although it is Nick. Nick's here. Follow my Twitter, Nixon. Hey, today is sad, melancholy, bittersweet. Not even sweet, just bitter. This is umami of the flavors. The one-year anniversary of Prince's demise. Dun, dun, dun. Sad.
It's heartbreaking. This is going to be one of those events where I think people outside of Minnesota might not give too, about. But for Minnesotans, for music lovers, this is one of those, like, do you remember where you were when you heard Prince died?
I was probably recording a show.
Yeah. I was at work, and the radio was on. There were speculations of there was an incident at Paisley Park. A lot of us didn't think too much of it. A lot of people work at Paisley Park, and then, as the morning went on, and the confirmations that it was Prince, and it was kind of,
oh. Tell a friend, spread the word, iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio. And we jumped into it right away, but this is a topic that needs to be jumped on. And I feel like with Prince, talked about on the show before, I'm a very much a surface fan, Prince. I'm not into the deep cuts. I like the hits, Purple Rain, Little Red Corvette, Nothing Compares to You, Pussy Control, And I still think that Prince's Super Bowl performance in 2006, I believe, is still the GOAT, is the gold standard of Super Bowl halftime performances.
It was definitely one of the most memorable ones.
Yeah. Well, here's my thing. Now, this might be sacrilege in Minnesota because I know that everyone is falling over themselves to worship Prince, but I actually kind of forgot that he lived in Minnesota still. I thought he had a place in the Hollywood Hills and just chilled out there all the time, but no, that was definitely not the case. And I don't know. I feel like when someone dies, there is a moment where they're embraced more warmly than they would have been if they're just living their life, continuing to do what they do. Like Kurt Cobain. If Kurt Cobain hadn't had his head blown off by the gardener, and I still believe that, he'd be, where would Kurt Cobain be right now?
Gosh, I mean, we can go on a long spree of, yeah. Would there be a Foo Fighters without the death of Kurt Cobain? I mean, there's so many things.
Oh, yeah.
Think about this. I mean, he could add more kids. Courtney Love, maybe their relationship might have kept the band going, or maybe they would separate much later. I don't know. That's a very interesting concept.
Kurt would have found happiness?
Nah, no.
I feel like that happens with a lot of musicians and comedians, is that they are tortured souls, and that comes across in the art, because it's very rare that you find a suburban 45-year-old dad with a steady job, good income, 2.5 kids in the suburbs, and he's coming out with some really deep music, man. Stuff that really resonates with me. Coming through, rolling in on my John Deere that's paid for. I didn't have to finance. And life is great. And we're going down to Revival to get some fried chicken later. It's going to be good. And then we're going to go to the IMAX and watch the movie. Yeah. No pain there. But you can definitely tell Prince, amazing artist. I do feel like The 1 year anniversary, all of the tributes and all of the concerts, all the get togethers are going to go down again. But I feel like then we're getting a little bit away from it. And I feel like we have to stop taking advantage of his death for promotion purposes. Every sports team around here adopted Prince stuff. Like the Wild's goal song was Let's Go Crazy this year. And I think it's, there's a fine line between making tributes, paying an homage, and just straight up pandering. Thoughts?
I question, I'm trying to think, Minnesota's other great musician, arguably, is Bob Dylan. If Bob Dylan would die, would the same thing, would it be as crazy or as upbeat as, upbeat, that's such a bad word, would it be like a Prince reaction would? Would people mourn? Would people go to the streets? Would there be concerts? Would the Wild play, you know, like when the Wild score next year, would they start playing?
No, would like, the Wild score, they play Hurricane. the entire song.
Like a Rolling Stone or something. I don't know. Put something with Prince and his death, I don't mind it as much just because I feel like he was such a pop icon. It was that big of a deal. You know, he was so big. It's hard to draw the line of if it's pandering. I don't know. I don't know if it is.
I think it does come into play the age at which Prince passed away and what age Bob Dylan would be if he passed away tomorrow, let's say. And, yeah, Prince was 50, I believe. He's pretty young. And, yeah, I do think the age compounds it a little bit. And it is funny. Like, after every celebrity dies, everyone goes on social media and goes like, oh, I can't believe Person X died. I was such a big of Person X. Really, you never brought them up once, ever. It's like, I am such a big fan of Dizzy Gillespie. He's been dead for 30 years. Oh, well, never mind then. Slowly back away.
Prince died at the age of 57.
Oh, wow. He was up there. How old he be? Pretty old. Yeah. So if Bob Dylan died, this would be the Wild after every goal. Yeah, but now that gets you pumped up, like Reuben Carter being falsely accused and framed of murder and needing rid of habeas corpus. But
I like that movie.
Yeah, and you could also counterpoint and make a good point that we're starting off the entire show today, and the show notes, show art is all about Prince, so you could say that we're pandering too, but no, we are homaging. Yes, because I'm straight up. I'm a very surface Prince fan. Yeah, it was sad that he died. Yeah, it was cool that he's very Minnesotan through and through. He had the Minneapolis sound came up. But hey, let's pay tribute to the real artist here. The artist currently known as Morris Day. I'm just kidding. And Nick, no. you're sort of in the same boat as me too, aren't you? Like,
yes. Surface-y. I'll truly admit that I liked Prince's hits. I couldn't name any obscure Prince songs. For me and my music, I liked Billy Joel. You know, uh-huh. If Billy Joel died, I can name a bunch of obscure Billy Joel songs. But Prince, no. This is, you know, Let's Go Crazy, 1999, When Doves Cry. Those are the tunes I'll remember for. The 90s, he had a lot of obscure stuff. I mean, when he changed his name to a symbol.
The symbol.
I mean, coming from someone who was born in 84, I was what, 8 to 10, you know, when he did this, I didn't understand what it meant to go by a name. And, you know, there's a lot of stories. One particular one I won't get too much into, but I recommend YouTubing Kevin Smith's version of when he met Prince.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting story. And, you know, he was very, Prince was very closeted and to himself. You know, you couldn't get any of his music. You can't copy a lot of it. He was very strict. He was very anal about it. A lot of his music you can't get a control of.
Sorry, so Nick, you're coming out and saying that Prince was closeted and also very anal. I mean, come on.
Sorry. Come on. I didn't mean it that way.
Yeah. Now, this is actually my favorite Prince deep cut, and there's a story behind it, but let's let Prince get into it a little bit here. Doon, 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 doon. This is called Pussy Control, by the way.
Nuestra presentación especial comenzará en breve.
This is my favorite Prince deep cut.
Un mensaje de nuestros auspiciadores.
I don't even know what that means. Down, down, down.
Yeah. Oh my God, it's a keytar.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and motherfucking girls. Your captain with
well,
no name
there goes the explicit rating.
Rock your world with a tale that will soon be classic about a woman you already know. No prostitute she, but the mayor of your brain.
What's the control?
Are you ready? Pussy control.
Now this is about the animal shelter departments.
Oh.
Is it? Yeah. And all right, so the backstory behind this is that in college, during Greek week, I was in a fraternity, and we did a sketch where I dressed up like Prince, and we pantomimed, we lip-synced to this song. It was amazing, and we beat the shit out of everyone because we were good, and I was the best Prince out there, and I smashed a guitar at the end. I don't know, I don't remember whose guitar it was, but it was great. Yeah, and it's funny, that was lip-sync battles before they were cool. So we were ahead of the curve by like 12 years, 11 years.
Oh my God, that's incredible.
Yeah, that's good. But let's really pay homage to the man. This is actually my favorite song of Prince.
A lot of people might not know that he wrote a lot of songs that a number of people have sang.
He wrote Baby, 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 Oh.
Really?
Baby, 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 Oh.
I think he wrote Manic Monday for the Bengals.
Really?
Yeah. I'll look it up.
I just want to be the rhythm guitarist in the back that's dressed like Nate Dogg.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Candy Dalton.
Yeah, but now that there's news of the impending legal battle, because Prince didn't have a will, so his estate and his potential heirs are all going after it, and it's the way that it's what usually happens when celebrities pass away. They have significant assets and don't have a really good estate plan in place. Like all of the sisters, all of the alleged children, all of the former managers, all of the blah blah blah, come out of the woodwork and start fighting over the scraps.
You have to admit that I do question the fact that there wasn't a will. I mean, I know, as we said, Prince is out there, but you think he would have had a legal team set up being like, hey, if something happens to you, Prince, should we kind of figure something out?
I don't know. Prince strikes me as the kind of guy who didn't think much past the next stanza of music or the next, over under 2,000 people Prince consorted with in his lifetime.
In his lifetime, I'll take the over.
Because, yeah, everyone goes back to the Wilt Chamberlain 10,000, but that's been mathematically debunked. And not because of his schedule on the road playing as an NBA basketball player, but just because of, like, refractory period. Like, it doesn't make sense. Like, unless he actually was, like, a human tripod.
That's interesting. Yeah. I don't know.
Now what counted, though? Because was it, like... If was this person in the room? Do they count? Were they watching? Were they on the old time camera with the crank? No.
I think it was the second one.
Well, we need some better light. Do they count? I don't know. Well, apparently, with the Gopher stuff, apparently, if you're in the room, you do count.
Yes, yes. So,
but yeah, with Prince, it's it is sad. Definitely lost his life way too early, I know that the news outlets have to run with the search warrants being revealed, but we all basically knew what was going on. He was abusing drugs. Yeah, they weren't in his name. They were in his bodyguard's name, whatever. And just OD'd. You know, it's pretty much like what happened to Michael Jackson, except it wasn't a doctor.
Yeah, and I think what sucks with the media now is that these type of stories come out, you know, obviously a week before. Today when, you know, obviously this is the 1-year anniversary, up to a week before there was a news article that broke about how they found all the opiates in his location. It's heartbreaking that to lose someone so young, but like going into the nitty gritty details, and yeah, you have to admit it. I want to know. I want to know all the backstory. I want to know like where he got these drugs. I want to know how much he took. I do want to know what was in his system. It's kind of, I want the bare bones of it. It's not respectful for me to do it, but I'm curious about it.
Well, it's somewhere we always worship our celebrities. We worship the idols, the musicians, the actors, the athletes, etc. Except if they have a really bad drug habit and then they pass away young, it's tragic in the moment, but in the grand scheme of things, how sad is it really if you're doing that to yourself? Like, it's if someone gets a dies driving drunk in a single car crash, you know, they smash it to a barrier or something, is it really a tragedy?
Ooh, wow, deep.
Yeah. And I know that this isn't exactly the tone of completely honoring the man, but like I said, great Minnesotan, and it's really cool that he's still stuck around here. A lot of Minnesotans, when they make it, quote unquote, they ditch us and go to New York or go to Los Angeles. And I feel like that's part of it, Prince's appeal too, and the fact that, you know, Minnesota, we're always the little brother, and with sports, we're always Charlie Brown, getting the football ripped away from us by Lucy. And when we can just have a little win, we love it with all our heart. I feel like that's what happened with Prince, too. Also, his music is good.
Yes, his music is good, and that's the one thing I think we should never forget about it. Because as long as we keep appreciating his music and his movie Purple Rain, which I'll admit I actually have not seen.
I've heard that is really bad.
I heard that too. I hear just like you see it for the music. You hear it for all the songs. I'm assuming all the songs get played. I'm assuming Purple Rain is sang in the song. Yeah. Sorry, folks, I haven't seen it, but, you know.
Well, is it like a porno in that you're only there for the music and then the acting in between is just sort of filler? Yeah, like a porn, you're there for the sex scenes, everything in between is filler?
I believe so.
All right, so this is Prince and Apollonia bedroom scene. Oh. I don't know what that means.
And, you know, Morris Day was, I believe, the bad guy in the film. Yes, I mean, listen, I'm saying he's a bad guy. As in, there's good guys and bad guys in a Prince film.
Oh, I think this is The Beautiful Ones. Eventually. Prince Rogers freaking Nelson.
You scared me. You didn't.
Why are you wearing that shirt, dude?
Game. Blouses.
Prince wrote Jungle Love?
So I assume so.
Song by the time.
No, Nick, say their name correctly.
Morris Day.
No. It's Morris Day in the motherfucking time.
Sounds like she's laughing, doesn't it?
All right. Prince, do something, because I'm really bored.
Do you always treat your women like that?
I don't have anybody right now.
All right. Now, this clip is Prince bitch slaps Apollonia. What? Prince, you're not allowed to do that, man.
I'm in Morris's group.
Huh?
What?
I'm going to join the time.
I'm going to join Morris's group.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Prince just straight up backhanded Apollonia. You are not joining the time. Wow. That was aggressive. This is on tape. This is like Ray. No, it's not. It's a movie.
No.
But yeah, Prince, 1 year later, still very sad. Should have been around for a number of more years. And isn't there like album coming out that might be in for some legal battles?
Yes. That's what's breaking on too. And this could be a good argument on who really controlled Prince's music at the time of his death. Because there are music engineers, and there was a music engineer who worked with Prince, and by the time of Prince's death, I think this engineer kind of had copies of all these songs that Prince was working on. And the engineer wanted to release the songs to the people. But obviously, Prince's music is controlled by an estate. You know, the whole group of the family, you know, group is trying to block it off and hold it off. I think the current tried to play some of the songs. You know, I mean, obviously, social media. I mean, media is going to try to... It's going to probably be released eventually, but yeah, I mean, estate legal stuff. I told you, Prince had issues, and Like, you know, you couldn't release Prince music on YouTube, but, you know, oh, is he like, he came after you. It was, it's ridiculous.
Baby. Actually might be my favorite Prince deep cut, the beautiful ones. And the only reason I know the song exists because it was covered by Mariah Carey and Drew Hill.
Not funny.
Yeah. You remember Drew Hill? No, no one does.
No one does. Yeah. No.
All right, so that's Prince, but Moore's Day.
Noise, 1, 2, 3, 4. Noise. Smoking weed. Doing coke, drinking beers.
Drinking beers. I love James Bob.
Rolling baddies, smoking blunts. We smoke the blunts. Rolling blunts and smoking.
Let me get a nickel back.
$15, little man. Put that shit.
The party's across the street, featuring the greatest band in the world.
Oh, me, oh.
World! Fourth day in the time!
We, oh.
Alright, I guess this clip is taking over because pause does not work on frickin' Morris Day.
Oh, Chanel is about to miss
it. Oh, yeah. Wait, wasn't Morris Day in Batman?
I don't know.
Remember the parade that the Joker put on? I'm pretty sure that was Morris Day. Girl, I want to know ya. All right.
Prince had the Bat Dance song. Remember that from that Batman movie?
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. Wait, Prince or Morris Day?
Prince.
Oh.
He had the song called, like, Bat Dance for, which was, it was weird.
Okay, now... Now we have to look that up. All right, Prince Bat Dance. This
it might be one of the weirdest things you've ever seen. Yeah. Like,
oh, I remember the song.
They split all the time, and like the music video, he's all purple and stuff, and I think he's wearing like weird masks.
That man should have been in purple.
Yep.
Wow.
Michael Keaton as Batman. So weird. A lot of people thought he was like the perfect Batman. I don't know.
Yeah, Academy Award winner Michael Keaton.
No.
Well, what did he win for? Birdman?
I think he won for Birdman.
All right. And I think he was nominated for Spotlight, too, wasn't he? Spotlight.
I don't remember that one. Yeah. I thought for sure the Birdman one he was.
New. Yeah, I think he won for Birdman. Also in the news, Aaron Hernandez. All right, now.
Should be laugh about
it. Yeah. All right, so Aaron Hernandez was discovered on Wednesday in his cell in correctional facility, hanged. Now, is it hung or hanged?
Hung.
He hung himself? He hanged himself?
He hung them.
I've seen it both ways.
I think it's hung himself.
Yep. And he apparently had John 3:16 scrawled on his forehead and wrist, and that was, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Okay. And the weird thing is, he was just acquitted of the double murder. His lawyer was probably, and his lawyer, Jose Baez, I believe his name is, got him off of the double murder, obviously, and also he was the guy who got Casey Anthony acquitted. So, super lawyer there. And he could have gone to working on the Odin Lloyd conviction, which he has a couple appeals left. And he could have been out in like 5-6 years. Because I don't think they could have got rid of the gun charges. But, yeah, it doesn't make sense why he would kill himself now after he was just acquitted of the double murder. And also, here's the weird thing. So, Odin Lloyd was the guy that Aaron Hernandez killed because he was worried that Odin Lloyd was going to snitch about this double murder. And so he was convicted and got a life sentence for killing a guy that was going to snitch on the double murder he's going to get away with anyways.
So it sounds like Inception 2 yeah. or something.
Inception 2 Electric Boogaloo. And here's the only thing I could think of that would give him some a reason to kill himself. In that there's a very arcane old Massachusetts state law that says if you die and you still have appeals left on a conviction, that conviction is vacated, right? So technically, Aaron Hernandez died not as a murderer, and if there's anything left in his estate, there's been talk that he was virtually broke. You know, like his legal defense has sucked up all of his NFL money. But if there's anything left, it can go to his daughter, and maybe he actually had a moment of clarity, actually a moment of trying to be a good person for once. And, or, and this is what this is probably more likely, he knew that he was going to get his ass sued in civil court by the Odin Lloyd family. So he was just like, nah, screw you guys. Deuces. I'm out.
That's so interesting. I don't know too much about that big of the of the football thing. From what I heard on the radio was that he grew up all right though. Like as a kid, he was fine up until like his high school, and then going to college. Then I guess he struggled a lot. And
well, he grew up in the suburb, just like a normal suburban kid. And then his dad died when he was 16, I believe. And by all accounts, that's what put him down a bad path. Went to the University of Florida, which, besides Tim Tebow, not exactly the most reputable characters in the world down there. And he just turned into this fake wannabe gangster, and then he ended up killing a couple people.
He was like a top tight end, wasn't he?
He was up there. Like him and Gronk were like the perfect tight end combination, because Gronk is obviously Gronk, and then Hernandez had a lot of versatility. Like I think he was like 6'2", 240. He got on the ball, and Belichick actually used him as a running back, as a fullback, quite often. And yeah, they were just a great combination of weapons. Pardon the pun. Actually, no, don't pardon the pun. For Tom Brady, and yeah, it's just really sad because Aaron Hernandez could have been a beacon of light for the minority communities. He could have been a guy who, did well, succeeded, and was able to talk to Latin American communities and be like, hey, be good, do this. And instead, he just decided to be a fake gangster and then take a bunch of angel dust and then kill himself.
I'm not too familiar with the jail scene. I don't watch any jail shows or anything. I'm trying to picture.
Because are you nervous, Nick?
It makes me nervous.
Nick, you wouldn't last in prison. We've been over this. You wouldn't.
I will off myself right away.
Yeah.
I just don't know how you hang yourself with bed sheets. Like, are there pipes that you can, like what's in a prison cell that you can...
Apparently it's from the window. Apparently there's still bars on the window, even though you could put, like, 6 inches of bulletproof glass and it would serve the same effect. And apparently, he was by himself, allegedly, and... Yeah, with the bed. Yeah, don't tell me that the cops didn't murder him because they left the bed sheets right in the cell. Hello, they're just asking for it.
And, and there were also accounts that he tried to barricade the door.
Yep.
So I mean, I don't know. It sounds like a suicide, but I mean, this is really the timing of this is really off. As you said, coming right off of. A non-guilty conviction for the other things. So this is very...
I actually think this could be gang-motivated. Like, you obviously don't want to read too much into it, but that's my job, so I'm going to do it. And, yeah, I've seen enough Sons of Anarchy, enough Oz. It says, gangs, they can get correction officers, COs, and prison guards to work for you for the price. If you know what I mean? Yeah. So, and Hernandez in prison, it's funny because he... kept showing up with different tattoos during the first trial. It was like, oh, so you're getting new ink in prison? What'd you do to get that ink? Yeah, just the whole fake gangster thing. Maybe he was off by another gang. Who really knows? Either way, really not even tragic, just really pathetic. Really pathetic all the way around.
As I said, I don't know too much about Aaron Hernandez, but I believe, he's kind of that thuggish character, but I don't know why I feel bad about this. It's just... I don't know. Wikipedia has a great article here, though. I was researching this while we were talking about it. The correctional facility has its own Wikipedia page. security class super max. I'm kind of shocked that he's in a maximum security prison. Like, is he do you think this was his choice, or do you
No, like anyone convicted of murder is going to be in a Supermax.
Supermax.
They're not going to put him at Club Fed. Hey, Bob, what are you here for? Well, securities fraud. Hey, Aaron, what are you here for? Murder.
I don't know how the prison system works.
How are we roommates? Yeah, it's, every time I look at a prison cell, and usually they're like 6x8, 8x8, and then you know you got your bed, you got your toilet, you got everything good to go. You have a little desk. I'm like, you know, if we get Wi-Fi in here, get a decent laptop, I'd be all right.
Yeah. I don't think you'll get that laptop though, and Wi-Fi, and you know.
How do you know, Nick? You don't watch any shows about prison?
Because no way
they're able to get phones in all the time. Nick, watch The Wire.
I do think I saw a news show where they talked about how someone had like a computer or something like hidden like in their jail cell. I'm like, how do you hide a computer?
MacBook Air. That's great marketing.
That's scary. They need to do the prison systems over again.
Also, doing over again, we'll take a little break. We'll try and do the second half of this show over again. I'll be right back with more Bull with Andy Carlson on Friday. So 2016 sucked for the Vikings, and also for a number of other reasons I heard, but it's okay. 2017 is upon us. Vikings fans, let's get going. All offseason, Purple for the Win coming right at you through free agency, the draft, and OTAs and training camp. Here we go. Get the show on 1500 ESPN Podcast One and the Podcast One app. Welcome back into the Blue Door Pub Thunderdome, and hey, fellas, the weekend is here, and you want to have a good time, you know, and your lady friend, get a little gift, at theenclosed.com. That's right, home delivery of the world's finest panties. We've been using them for a couple months here at the Carlson household, and let me tell you, it's good time. It's like it's like VJ Day, yeah, the end of World War II. Wait, no, VE Day, like when like people in the streets and just like making out stuff. It's great, it's fantastic. And here's what you do: you go in and you and your significant other, you can pick your preferences. You got the thongs, you got the classic, you got the boy shorts. You can do whatever you want. There's some unmentionables, maybe something I don't even know about. Yeah, and you pick 1, 3, 9, or 12. Month subscription, hit that up. And if you use the code PFTW, just like Purple FTW, PFTW as a coupon code at checkout, you save $15 off any order. Ah, I love them. Yeah. Antonia and The Enclosed, they're wonderful sponsors. We love them. You should love them too. TheEnclosed.com. Remember, code PFTW, $15 off any order. Hit them up, TheEnclosed.com. All right. So we're coming back, Nick, and, the only drawback about prison, besides the constant threat of sexual assault and being murdered and violence, probably the food.
Yeah. After all those other things, I can't imagine them being like fine course meals. But
yeah, because just think of like school lunch, and I think schools and prisons have the same dietary guidelines.
I mean, it'd be a great way for me to get in shape because, you know, you're eating, like, bare minimum, not, you know, greased up food. It's probably just, you know, enough to keep you alive. But then again, you probably have the threat of all your inmates who are probably going to, like, knife you if you don't give them your breadstick or whatever.
Or, like from the movie Life, you're going to eat your cornbread. All right, so we have a sample from the MarshallProject.org of a sample. This looks like a breakfast, I guess. Sample prison meal plan, 2,118 calories per day, $1.77 average per meal. Too much. No lunch is served. Yeah. So breakfast, it's coffee. Yeah, 1% milk, half a cup of fruit juice, half a cup of canned fruit. Now, think of like the canned fruit cocktail. That's about it. You get, oh, not even butter. You get margarine. Well, yeah, you should be punished. You're in jail. Captain Crunch and milk, and then a biscuit and 2 cups of country gravy. So you get your shit on a shingle. Good stuff. And this looks like dinner. A cup of beans.
No.
A cup and a half of meat fried rice. So not even chicken, not even just meat fried rice. A slice of cake. They're getting cake in prison? What the shit is this? Mother shitter.
Oh, my God, is it?
Two pieces of cornbread and 1 cup of vitamin beverage.
Vitamin? They can't say V8?
Well, I don't know if it's V8. It might just be something so they don't get scurvy. Yeah. Wow. Either way, not like overly appetizing. We're going through some of these. This one's from Arizona. Carrots. Yeah. They get brownies? Shit, I kind of want to go to prison now. A cup of mashed potatoes, 5 ounces of turkey soy casserole. Never mind, I don't want to go. But, soy? Come on.
All these pictures come with the plastic fork, yeah, because obviously they're not going to trust you with silverware.
Yeah. And also they're fully on the six-section lunch trays. You know, it's got the thing on the side for your utensils. You got the round circle, then you got the rectangle. That's where the pizza used to go. Yeah.
You know,
rectangle pizza, baby.
I feel like those trays almost indirectly cause a lot of people to be kind of OCD-ish, yeah, when it comes to food, like now. Because if I'm making a meal for myself and I have, like, if I'm making vegetables, if I have, like, a main course chicken or something, I keep it divided. I don't like it when they mix. I feel like this...
That's racist, Nick.
I'm sorry. I think I was maybe unintentionally raised that way. Due to school lunches.
Speaking of racists, let's do the news.
You are fake news.
Sir,
go ahead.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
I ain't got time to believe.
You can't handle the truth.
The news with Uncle Nick.
All right, Nikki, what's going on in the world today?
Okay, well, we got to talk about a long-running story that's happened since the beginning of the week, and it has to do with social media. Yes, we're going to talk about the Facebook... deemed the Facebook Live killer.
Did you watch the video?
Yes, I did.
What was it, bad? Was it graphic?
It wasn't too graphic, but I'm a typical guy. I love action films, and you know.
No, Nick, this is an action film. This is a snuff film.
But when I get to it, let me, you know, to sidetrack.
This is like 8mm shit.
Yeah, and so I wouldn't think it would have bothered me watching it. I'm like, oh, you know, people shoot guns all the time, you know, like, yeah, in action films. But to see a first-person shooting from their perspective, the guy walks up to this old man who's just walking. The old man's trying to protect himself with his bag. And then you see a gun shoot towards the guy. The camera turns away. Then it turns back, and you see the guy dead on the ground. It's
That's messed up.
It's horrible. What? And, sorry, go ahead.
I can't watch stuff like that. Like, in college, I watched a beheading video. I'm just like, yeah, that was a little much. That was a little much. It was too far. Too far.
Well, one day we'll talk about all the gross stuff that you can find online.
It was, I'm sure it was like a precursor of ISIS, of, you know, like the sawing off of the head with like the rusty knife. And it's just like, it literally sounded like a pig. Like halfway through, it sounded like a stuck pig. Like the, yeah. That's why, Nick, I don't watch beheading videos anymore.
Well, I mean, I think about a year or two ago, there was a news camera shooting where they were filming, and you could see someone with a gun come in and shoot. This was much worse, though. Yeah. And the killer, his name is Steve Stevens. Yeah. Excellent name.
No, that 100%, that kid was going to grow up to be a killer. Like, I blame the parents. If the parents are still alive and around, Let's incarcerate them. Let's make them eat the tuna and soy casserole.
Yeah, and as far as I know here, there wasn't any rhyme or reason why he was just upset. He was blaming the shooting on a girlfriend or something.
Of course,
and
it's the chick.
And it's one of the horrible reasons of why does social media exist. You know, I mean, it's taking a big hit because this was televised live on his Facebook account. I don't know who many friends he has, but... I was able to find a video of it. I mean, the internet, when it comes to a murder case like that, I mean, a lot of people go in and we try to remove this horrific stuff. But I was
wasn't up on Facebook for like 2 hours.
It was up there for a while.
Yeah. And what kind of sick effing person are you if you go on there? It's like, I'm gonna share this. My entire timeline needs to see this, man. It's like that baby being born. All right, let's do this.
Yeah. What stayed on the internet a lot longer was his confession and him in the car explaining it. And
also, why did it take so long for people to find him?
I think he was on the road. I think he stayed low key on the road. And thankfully, as of Friday, what has happened is that he was caught. I believe Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
I believe it was Tuesday or Wednesday. He was caught. Thanks to people at McDonald's, he was cited at McDonald's, yeah. And the drive-thru people, I think, stalled him while contacting the police. And then there was a short chase, and then I believe he just took his own life. And, hell, thankfully, it's the end of Steve Stevens, and it's just horrific. It's, his victim was an elderly man, and no one should go like this. And the interviews with his with the children, it was heartbreaking. And, you know, you called the Facebook killer. What?
Yeah.
What a horrible name. A horrible name. What a horrible story this was.
Now, it would have been way worse, just to bring it down to micro levels, if his name was Nick Asuncion.
Whoa.
That's actually something I fear, because Andy Carlson is a relatively common name. And if, there's like a 1 in 50 chance that this Facebook killer could have been named Andy Carlson. And I would have just been like, shit. Yeah. And like, yeah, let's call him Facebook killer. Oh, you mean Andy Carlson? No. Facebook killer.
For all the Steve Stevens out there. I mean, it almost sounds like a fake name.
No, it'd be like, if a kid was born in Gitmo, say they detained a female pregnant terrorist, sure. And then the kid was born there. It's like, yeah, let's torture the kid too. Stevens. That's what we're going to do. So we're going to name him. Yeah.
Stevens.
Let's talk about something else.
All right, let's chew up a little bit. All right, story from Minnesota. Awesome. Yesterday was 420. You guys all know what 420 is, right?
Now, do you think people actually participate in 420, or if it's just a meme?
I think people participate
still,
in it, too.
Still like just like a big round joke. It's like, ha, 420.
But then I think there are people who regularly smoke pot, who just they'll do it for the hell of it anyways, but then they'll be like, it's 420, dude. But then,
hey, man.
But then they'll forget.
Hey, man, we get to smoke weed day.
All right, well, the Star Tribune posted something from a Wyoming, Minnesota police department Twitter, which is something we should also talk about. Police stations and counties all have Twitter accounts now, which is really, really weird. But to make fun of 420, they posted a picture of, and this was like super early in the morning, about 4 a.m. on Thursday. They were setting a trap for all the people who were smoking pot. And what's the best stereotype for people who smoke pot? They want the Doritos, the Cheetos, the Grand Theft Auto, the Battlefield Hardline, Bagel, White Castle, and Mountain Dew. And then in the backdrop, there's a cop car and a guy and a police officer with a giant net.
And the Wyoming PD Twitter account is pretty famous around these parts for being fantastic.
Do they need to be? I mean, were they very active when it comes to, like,
catching bad guys?
Or, like,
didn't catch the Facebook killer, that's for sure.
I mean, with all the stuff that's happened, especially, like, in Minnesota, I mean, you got to be careful with these with the social media, especially the police department, because you can, you know, they could maybe post something inappropriate, or, you know, they could.
Who's going to get mad at something like this? Who's going to be clutching their pearls? Definitely not the stoners. Stoners don't protest, man.
And this is kind of weird because this is in Minnesota, which has just passed a lot of medical marijuana stuff, which could maybe one day be marijuana. It could be a marijuana pro state. I don't know.
I'm trying to figure out where. Wyoming. Oh, it's north of Forest Lake. All right, that makes sense. I have a long-standing beef with Forest Lake.
What's wrong with Forest Lake?
I don't know. I just started it for no reason. It's like, you know, they got fake rap beefs just so that both parties can get attention. Yeah, that's me and Forest Lake. I got Forest Lake diss track coming up. You know that you're fake when you say you're from Forest Lake, because why can't you be from a real lake? You got 9,999 other to choose from. Yeah.
All right, so I never really smoked pot in my life.
Never really? Wait, what about that time you smoked out of an apple after you bleached your hair?
It wasn't out of an apple, and no.
That's too specific to be made up.
No, there wasn't an apple. It was a normal bong. Anyway, I just wanted to clarify, are these normal stereotypes, the Cheetos, Doritos, Mountain Dew kind of stuff?
Yeah.
But, you know, because I see it in, you know, movies, TV all the time and stuff, but obviously White Castle, that's hilarious.
Yeah, it's almost trope, yeah. I feel like, I'm, you know, not a big weed smoker either, but if I was, like, if honestly, if they made it recreational, like legalized, I'm probably partaking a little bit more. Except my, I don't know, like, Doritos kind of, this is probably a hot take, Doritos kind of suck. I'm not going to lie. Like, they're fine.
I'm a cool ranch guy when it comes to not, I know there's a big divide between people who fan like nacho cheese versus I was a cool ranch myself, you know, and I was not a fan when Taco Bell did the Dorito tacos. I don't care for them at all.
Oh, they're perfect in walking tacos. You ever had those?
Oh, where yeah.
You take the bag, you crush it up, and then you put all the taco fixings in. It's like, those are really good. But they jumped the shark. They would have been fine just with nacho cool ranch, except then they introduce all the habanero fire humper flavors. And it's like, no, you're fine. It's like Coke come out with new flavors. Vanilla Coke.
Have you seen all the fast food places that have the Coke machine now? You can get like dozens of...
That's so dumb.
I wonder if they cost more.
For what?
For those machines.
I imagine so. Funny thing about vanilla Coke, that's exactly what Captain and Coke taste like, except without the booze. So it's like, oh, I'm teasing my brain. I feel like I should be getting drunk.
It almost makes... I remember Taco Bell. Yeah, talk about Taco Bell again. They had like a weird Mountain Dew flavor, like a fruity flavor. It reminded me of back when we were in college and doing like the UV vodka stuff when we were mixing like the Sprites and like the UV blue. And then I was like, oh, I don't know why we ever did that. That was so much sugar.
Do you remember the Flaming Dr. Pepper?
I remember of it.
Because I'm trying to remember what it was. I know it was Everclear, and then you lit the shot on fire, you blew it out, and then you dropped it in the thing, and then you drank it like an Irish car bomb.
I don't know if we did we partake in that?
Yeah. Yes, we did.
I feel like we would have hurt ourselves more when trying to mix fire, but I love finding YouTube videos of the people who have the flaming shot, and they drink it when it's on fire still. And like the fire is all over their face.
All right, so you take a 16-ounce beer. There you go. And you take a shot, you fill it up 3/4 full of amaretto. That's where you get the sweetness of Dr. Pepper from. And then you top it off with Everclear. And then you light the Everclear on fire. Then you're like, cheers, bitches. You blow it out, you drop the shot into the beer, and then you chug it, and it tastes like Dr. Pepper. It really does.
Like a light beer or something? Like a light or something?
You don't do like a gooseneck IPA, Nick. Come on.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't know how these kids work nowadays. When was the last time you and I have been out like heavy drinking and...
I don't know.
Kids.
I actually kind of miss the college days of drinking where you get a 30 rack of Cool Light for like $12. I mean, that was fantastic back in the day. But now every time we go to the bar, and trust me, I love my craft beer. I love our friends over at Indeed Brewing especially. But there is just sometimes where I just really want a Bud Light, which I know is really not popular to say, especially in the brewing culture we have here in Minnesota. But just sometimes, yeah, I don't want a filling beer. I don't want something that I have to, like, appreciate the hints of persimmon and coriander. It's like, no, just give me the swill. Like, give me the ugly American piss water. I don't care.
I drink Coors Light quite a bit, obviously, because you call me on it when I call your Andy LaGrief show. Because, you know, I want to drive, and I'm not here to promote, you know, drinking and driving, but I can have one, two Coors Lights and be fine. You know, with the craft beers, when you have if you have a couple, then you're like, I'm kind of full. I don't trust myself.
Yeah, and All right, so this is probably another hot take, too. I've never been a fan of drinking while eating. Like, I like them being separate. Like, everyone talks about getting a burger and a beer or a pizza and a beer or having wine with your meal. And I don't know, like, I always like the meal separate. Like, you have a drink beforehand, you get the meal, you eat the meal, then you have a drink afterwards. I don't know. It might be, like, the OCD-ness, but I just never was a fan of the combining-ness.
I can understand that. It can be filling, yeah.
Yeah. All right. What's next?
All right, we're going to go a little...
That's Wyoming PD.
Yes. All right, let's talk a little nerdiness, a little gaming nerdiness. Last year, we all remember a big surprising hit was the miniature Nintendo NES.
Nope.
Okay. Quick reminder. So if you guys were born in the 80s and grew up in the 90s, Nintendo was the big video game system, and Nintendo released a mini NES, so like just a plastic console that came with a controller, and it had about 20 to 30 games on it,
mm-hmm.
which was fantastic. If you're a big fan of old school Nintendo, because, you know, all those Nintendo games, you know, can fit in like a very small space now because it's 2017. This was a big seller, and they don't even sell the Nintendo NES anymore, or the NES, the Mini anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But rumors came out this week that for this Christmas, they are going to release one for the Super NES.
Yeah.
And that was, Super NES was my big video game system. I loved. Yeah,
that was mine too. That was my favorite Christmas gift when I was five, six, somewhere in there.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I loved it. So the rumors are out. I don't know if there's any guarantees right now by the time we're recording this what games would be on there. Mm-hmm. But like the NES version, you're going to probably have Super Mario World, maybe the F-Zero, Super Metroid, Zelda, Star Fox maybe, F-Zero.
Oh, Star Fox is great.
You know, there's a lot of stuff. Chrono Trigger, Secret of Mana, you know, the big RPGs were kind of becoming popular, the Final Fantasies. A lot of games, but there's a lot of critics right now, and they want to make sure that if this is going to happen.
Yeah, this is happening.
Star Fox.
Yeah. We got Star Fox. What was the first planet? Cornea?
Cornea, yeah.
Bring it on, bitch. Don't. Yeah, remember that music came on and it was on. It was on, baby.
Use the bomb right now to take them out.
Huh. No, you're just going. You're just going for it.
I
really want to play Star Fox now.
I have it. I'll bring it next time.
I guess, well, we have a Super Nintendo in somewhere in the closet. Nice.
Oh, look. All bosses, no damage, no hits, no bombs. That's tough.
Yeah, I feel like Star Fox could have been. They could probably make Star Fox into a movie.
Yeah,
I'd watch that.
I agree. I think. Well, I love the Super NES version. The N64 one was pretty tight and got it. But like how classic those geometric shapes
those
are.
Those 8-bit graphics. I think this is Macbeth. Macbeth is the planet I can never get to. Because the third route was really tough.
Yeah.
Oh, you did it.
Oh, that's the final. That's Venom.
Oh, yeah. All right.
Screw that. As I said, the NES one was so popular when it came out last year, and like they stopped making it now, mm-hmm. even though demand is still high. You can go online and find the NES system one. For probably a couple $100, I think some people are trying to market it for. But saving the Super NES one, if it's going to come out this Christmas, it will probably be one of the biggest things, especially because the generation who loves the SNES,
mm-hmm.
our generation, you know, the money spenders, you know, will fork out some good money.
Well, there you go, listeners. For Christmas, well, actually, Nick's birthday is coming up sooner.
Mm-hmm.
No, but it's coming on Christmas, right?
Yes. Yeah. This is coming out Christmas.
Christmas. Get Nick that. That's the news.
The news with Uncle Nick.
From the entire Channel 4 news team, I'm Veronica Corningstone.
And I'm Ron Burgundy. Go f*** yourself, San Diego.
Nick, what you got going on this weekend, man?
I'm going to continue packing. I'm moving to the western suburbs. I got to get all my...
Oh, yeah, you're
going to
become a cake eater.
I'm not going to become a cake eater.
Cake is delicious.
If it's good cake, I will eat it.
Also, we might do a burrito challenge this weekend.
Oh, yes. I definitely want to that.
And I would dominate you.
I don't think so.
Yeah, well, we had a discussion because I feel like big guys actually don't eat much, like, in one sitting. And I can house like a decent amount of food. Like, I'm not the skinniest guy in the world either, but I'm not Kobayashi. But I could do decent in an eating contest.
No, I'm a big guy and I love to eat, but I'll admit I've noticed my appetite hasn't been that big much. It's probably because I'm slowly dying from the inside because of all the food that I eat. But burritos are a fantastic food, though. I mean, if you can find a good place to make a good burrito, and we're going to a place in Eagan that we last time we were there, our friends ordered burritos. You know, I had street tacos, and you know, a burrito, not like a Chipotle burrito, but with one the size of the frickin' plate.
Yeah. Well, one that they don't even roll. It's one that they just fold the flaps over and flip it over.
And they're like good luck.
They call that burrito. Hey, good luck. Fiesta Cancun, is that the place?
That sounds right.
All right, yeah, because I want to give them a little plug, a little love. There we are. So we're going to do that. I'm probably going to die. And by die, I mean I'm going to win and earn so much glory for my clan and family. That's what we do. Also, what you should do, hey, if you're buying that Super Nintendo for Nick this Christmas, do not through our Amazon link, bullshow.co/Amazon. Take it right to the homepage, and here's what you do. After you go there, bookmark a little home. And every time you shop on Amazon, whether you're buying antacid after you try a burrito challenge against me and lose, or if you're buying Nick some video games before he dies, and then, ooh, in your will, you should put that I will inherit all your video games.
Okay.
So there you go. In a year, I'll get those video games. Bullshow.co/Amazon. your one stop. Amazon. You already do. Easiest way to support us, baby. All right. Have a good weekend. Get out there. Hopefully enjoy some nice weather here in the Twin Cities, or if you're somewhere else. I don't know what the weather is, and I don't really care. I'm just kidding. I care about you, baby. Yeah. I was talking with producer Allie about this earlier. I'm still dumbfounded that people actually listen to stuff that I put out.
What do you mean? What?
No, I mean, when we're recording, like, at max, I'm around, like, three people. You know, like, Andy Luke and Football Machine, we got three people. And it still just dumbfounds me that there's thousands and tens of thousands of listeners. It still is like, wow, was there a mistake? Why are they listening?
Well, I like to think that you're entertaining. I enjoy listening to you talk. And you
know. Wife doesn't think so.
You know, and I'm not just saying it because you're one of my best friends who I've known forever, but...
I like the way you talk, boy.
You're informative for people who aren't as knowledgeable of sports, you know, as you are, you know.
Even though I feel kind of bad. I think I kind of threw Prince under the bus early on, but that's okay.
It's... I wasn't throwing him under the bus. It's fine.
Yeah, because that would kill him.
That
might be too far. iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, YouTube, and follow me on Twitter at Andy Carlson Show, Nick's at Nick's Son, and also check out our Instagram as well, at Andy Carlson Show. If you enjoy it, tell a friend, spread the word, add to the Jerome Army. It's all about word of mouth. You know, we don't have a marketing budget, and we're just very humble family of podcasts here at Carlson Digital, so keep on doing that. And thanks, producer Allie, for making me not sound so stupid today. But for Nick, I'm Andy Carlson, saying, and young, sayonara, and bye-bye. I'll talk to you Monday, biatches.
Thanks for listening to Bull with Andy Carlson, Minnesota's 87th best daily podcast. Download the show on iTunes. Everyone's middle name is Jerome.